them to come to me and have a relationship with me. So it is our job to not be partial and show favoritism to people based upon what we see. Because favoritism is a sin. When we look at this passage of Scripture, James tells them that favoritism is sin. Verse 8, he says, yes, indeed, it is good when you obey the royal law as found in the Scriptures. These people are not bad people. If you're here today and you say, I have a problem sometimes showing favoritism. I have a problem sometimes, Pastor, with prejudice and stereotypes. Can I tell you that that doesn't mean that God doesn't love you and that God doesn't care about you and that you're not a Christian, but it does mean this, that if you recognize that in your life and the Lord is showing you that through His Word, that it must change. That you cannot stay there. That God wants that to be something that we change in our lives. Love your neighbor as yourself is what He said. He said, you fulfill the Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, but you favor some people over others. You are committing a sin. You are guilty of breaking the law. The body of Christ must guard against favoritism. You see in this passage of Scripture, in the first verse, he says, my brothers and sisters, these are not bad people. He considered them to be dear. They are people that James considered friends, and he considered them to be spiritual family members. He said, my dear brothers and sisters, but he also saw in their lives that there was a fault. And the fault was they were looking at the outward appearance. They were making judgments. And we see that he tells them that favoritism nullifies your testimony. Because he said, how can you claim to have faith if you show favoritism to one another? Listen. If we have faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, as I've already said, we are going to be reaching out to every man, woman, boy, and girl, and we are going to recognize that there is no such thing as a hopeless case. Because each and every one of us came to God a sinner. It's just some of us came with a little more sin than others. Some of us came with a few more regrets than the others. Some of us may have came with a little harder life. But we have learned from this passage of Scripture that you want to know something, it doesn't matter how much sin you got in your life. Sin is sin. And we have been cleansed and we have been washed by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. So we can recognize that at the foot of the cross, the ground's level. And that those who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, they are brothers and sisters, regardless of how much they make or what the color of their skin may be. Favoritism not only is sin, but favoritism makes us judges. We see in this passage of Scripture that we judge based on outward appearances. We talked about this. But James tells them, look at what he says. He said, you see somebody come in with fancy clothes and expensive jewelry. And you see another come in and they're wearing dirty clothes. How many of you remember the day when you went to church and you had two outfits? You had the one you wore every day of the week. And then on Saturday night, you went down and you took your Saturday night special. And you got your bath, you got cleaned up, and you had your good overhauls, and you had a good dress, and that's what you wore to church. Now, I'm not from that era, but I've heard a lot of people talk about that era, that that's what they did. You didn't have a lot. Okay, can I tell you today, young people, we don't really know what hard times are, most of us. Hard times for most of us is if we don't have the Xbox One, or we don't have the PS4, or we don't have the 129-inch television. That's hard times for us. But times have been a lot harder in the past. We are blessed. But the facts are this. So often we make split-second decisions. I'll get that word out. Split-second decisions. About people based on simply what they look like. I feel sorry for ladies today. I go to the grocery store, and where I go to the grocery store, there's always a line, and so I have plenty of time to sit there and read the magazines. And one of the things that I have noticed is that they don't put real ladies on the front of those magazines. Have you noticed that?
That's right.
They put airbrushed ladies on those magazines. And men, they will walk down the street and they can look at a lady and they can make a split-second decision based upon an individual. And ladies can make the same decision based upon the way a man dresses. If he's got a nice suit on, you know, that can mean, hey, there's a rich, successful businessman. It may mean he's got only one nice suit and he's out looking for a job. You never know the situation. But the fact of the matter is, we judge so much on the appearance. We'll see somebody and they drive a nice car. You see somebody driving down the road and they've got a Corvette. I saw a Corvette the other day and I was sitting at the light and I was going, Lord, I'm glad I'm not preaching on coveting today, this week. I mean, it was nice. I could see my reflection in the mirror. I could see my reflection in the paint. And he pulled up beside me. There's just something about that growl. It just sounds mean. I pushed my little Avalon's accelerator. I'm yelling in the back seat, kids, wind up the rubber band in there again. I mean, he just got a bad sounding car and he takes out. I mean, everybody's looking at him as he goes down the road because it's the brand new one off the showroom floor. Nobody looks at me that way. My car's 4 years old, my car's now 7 years old. And nobody looks at me that way in my Avalon. And I'm sitting there going, oh man, now there is a successful man. He must be doing something right because he could drive a Corvette. My grandpa used to say there's two types of people in this world. There's three types of people in this world. There's rich people, there's poor people, and there's people with good credit. And it's your decision to figure out which one he is. Because he may be as in debt as the next man. I had a man that I used to fish with at Blue Ridge Assembly of God. His name was Glenn Satterfield. He said, Pastor, I want to let you know something. He said, I know how pastors think sometimes. Said somebody walks into the church and said the first thing goes through their mind is they've got a nice car and they've got a nice set of clothes on and their wife's got jewelry all over it. The first thing goes through their mind is, we are so happy to see you. Because they think there's financial stability, there's money coming into the church. He said, I want to tell you something, Pastor. He said, you'll find out that some of the boys that's out there just wearing the old bib coveralls have got more money sitting in the front of their bib coveralls than those boys that's got the big fancy clothes.
Yes,
you know, I've learned something in the church. I've learned something in the Church of God. Do you know that most of the time it would shock you if you look at the financial records that the people who give the most to the church? Because so many times, I'm not saying this is the way all the time, sometimes it's not, but I will tell you that many times the ones that will give the most to the kingdom of God will be the little widows in the church, or those who have very little, but you might know something, they have a heart for God and they give. You'd say, well, Pastor, it's surely the people that own the businesses, it's surely the people that have the big, no, it's people that just have what God's given them and they're faithful to the Lord with it. You'll find out that they are the ones that support the church more than the people that we would consider to be wealthy. I'm not saying that's always the case, but predominantly. We need to realize that we cannot judge things from the outward appearance. I went to a job testing this week. When was the last time you took a test? 25 years for me. I decided I wasn't going to study for it because if I didn't know by now, I wasn't going to learn it. So I had to take a test on filing, had to take a test on typing. They gave me questions, and for the first
time they put a test in front of me, I froze because I'd forgotten how to take a test. I got done with the test, though, and I was sitting there, and I was kind of measuring everybody up. And I was looking at the guy beside me, and I was like, well, you know, I'm probably better than him. I got a better chance. I wore my best clothes in. I'd taken the typing test, and it was one of those typing tests that they let you have a practice test, and so they let us practice for 1 minute. I had a chance to take a second practice test of 1 minute if I wanted to, but you know, I went the first time and I got 60 words a minute. I thought, I'm good to go. So I hit take the real test. I clicked the real test, and I no more clicked that button that said take the real test, and she said, now this real test is not 1 minute. This real test is for 5 minutes. 5 minutes of solid typing. And I was like, I've never typed for 5 minutes continuously in my life. And so I started typing, and I got done, and I had hit 60 words a minute, 5 minutes. I was like, well, that is pretty good. And I thought, you know, I bet I did a lot better than this guy over here. I don't know what that man had done for a living, but he must have been a professional typist. Because she went over and looked at his typing, and I thought, you know, I'm doing pretty good at 60 words a minute, and she went, and I had 96% accuracy, and I was like, hey, I'm doing good. She went over and looked at his. He was doing 88 words a minute with 99% accuracy. And I was like, I would never guess him to be an office man or a typist. You see, we make judgment calls every day based upon strictly appearance. This pastor does that. You see, favoritism is sin, but it is also sin to judge people based upon what you see from the outward appearance, because that's not what God does. They were making judgment calls based upon appearance of fancy clothes, expensive clothes, dirty clothes. We make assumptions. I would like to call those stereotypes. We say that fancy people are rich, dirty people are poor. We assume wealthy people are worthy of honor, and wealthy people will be good examples to set before our people, and people will be offended if they see the rich, if they see the poor and they come into the services, they'll be offended if they see the poor. Wealthy people, they will help us financially. People, poor people, they will have nothing to offer. We can make those decisions, and if we make those types of decisions based upon the outward appearance, we are committing sin. My friends, that's what the Word has called it. We need to realize that each person has value in the sight of God.
That's
right. Let me tell you that many of the people that have wealth, not always, but many people who have wealth have got it from dishonest gain. Many times they have been willing to sell their soul for the almighty dollar. Sometimes they can look good on the outside, but when we see them according to God's Word, we see that their life is as filthy rags, and they are not someone that we need to look to as an example or put in front of our people. We need to recognize we cannot judge from the outward appearance. And another thing that we see is when we make these judgments and we make assumptions that we're going to see that our judgment is distorted. Favoritism distorts our judgment according to verse 5. In verse 5, we read these words, listen to me, dear brothers, hasn't God chosen the poor in this world to be rich in faith? Aren't they the ones who will inherit the kingdom he promised and those who love him? But you dishonor the poor. Isn't it the rich who will oppress you and drag you into court? Aren't they the ones who slander Jesus Christ, whose noble name you bear? You see, we can have our vision be distorted because of favoritism. We can just have our judgment distorted. We fail to see other people properly. But we need to recognize that God has made the poor rich in faith. Some of the greatest people that I've ever known in my life that have been prayer warriors and people of faith have been people that we would look at today and we would say they had absolutely nothing. They lived in a modest home. Sometimes the home most of us would never live in. But I can tell you that if you needed somebody to pray for you, you knew where to go. Because there in that little living room beside their couch, they could get on their knees and they could touch God. We need to realize that even though we may look at someone and we may say that they don't have anything to offer, let me tell you something. If you've got a person and they may know nothing on this side of eternity, they may be somebody that we would not consider to be blessed. If they are the kind of individual that has a close relationship with Jesus Christ and they know how to touch heaven with their prayers when the need is there, you've got a person that has much to offer to the church of Jesus Christ. They have great faith because their faith is having to depend on God for everything they get. Let me tell you, my friends, they have a place in the body of Jesus Christ. James said, listen, it's the rich who oppress you. It's the rich who are your bosses. It's the rich that make your life miserable. But yet you're wanting to bring them in and you're wanting to exalt them. I want to let you know that today that God loves people, and today I'm not on people who have much. That's not what we're doing here, because you want to know something? God uses people even with money too. God uses everybody. And I will tell you that there are people out there that God has blessed that are great blessings to the kingdom of God. I think of people like the owner of Hobby Lobby, who closes his business down on Sunday. And who's that other guy? Chick-fil-A, he closes down on Sunday. And I can tell you that those men are money people who have great wealth. But I will also tell you, they are people who have great generosity to the kingdom of God, and they bless the kingdom of God. There's nothing wrong with wealth. Wealth is not sin. It's the love of money that becomes sin. Wealth is not sinful. Wealthy people God uses just as much as those who are poor, but we cannot differentiate between them. We cannot show favoritism between them, because you want to know something? God doesn't see their wallet. We fail to see people properly. We fail to see ourselves properly. You see, favoritism is hard to diagnose, because we fail to be honest with ourselves sometimes. But God's Word is always honest with us. And God's Word will show us who we really are. And James said, listen, you can't show favoritism to people based upon their money. Favoritism happens to godly people. Favoritism happens to people who know the Word of God. But it is something that we must be diligent to make sure that we are not showing preferential treatment to people based upon what they have to offer us. Because he says, listen, if you do that, your motives are evil. I was looking through the passage of Scripture where he said that if you show favoritism, that you sin. I couldn't find a scripture in the Bible that said if you show favoritism, you sin. But I did find this based upon money. I did find this passage of scripture in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 15. It says this: do not twist justice in legal matters by favoring the poor or being partial to the rich and powerful. Always judge people fairly. Justice is to be blind. Justice is to be impartial. We are supposed to be just to each and every person. In this passage of Scripture, James was talking about money. But there's a lot of other ways that we can be impartial. Sometimes it's not just rich and poor. But sometimes it can be the color of our skin. Sometimes it can be education. Those who have the great education, maybe those who don't have education. Let me tell you something, that there's some very wise people out there in the world that never went to college a day in their life, but through the school of hard knocks, they learned a lot. Prejudice has no place in the body of Christ. Now, this is not something we like to hear, because we always say that we are not prejudiced. And sometimes when we hear the word prejudice, we think color of skin. But we can be prejudiced in so many different areas. We can be prejudiced because people don't believe the way we believe. Did you know that there's some people out there that think that only Pentecostals are going to get to heaven? I got news for you. There's going to be a lot of people in heaven that we didn't expect to be there. And there's going to be a lot of people we're going to be surprised that didn't make it, because we thought they had everything right. But see, that's the secret. God's looking not at the outward appearance. God's looking at the heart. You know, when I look at people, I can only see the outward appearance. God knows what's going on the inside. So if God knows what's going on in the inside and I can't know what's going on the inside, my job is just to love everybody the same. And I'm not saying that's always easy. Have you ever met somebody you didn't want to be loved? Can I tell you that people can be prejudiced towards you? And when you encounter that, it's not easy to deal with. Young people today, let me say something to you, because you're starting out in life, and if I could do things over, I would do things over. But you judge a lot on, your friends judge you a lot by the clothes you wear, the way you look. If I could give you some words of advice, quit worrying about your friends. And start worrying about just pleasing God. Because I can tell all you people that's in junior high and getting ready to go into high school that the day is going to come that you're going to walk a line, you're going to graduate, and you will probably never see those friends again. Or if you do, you won't see them very often. And everybody's life's going to go their opposite directions, and life's going to move on. And the things that you guys put importance in is not important. As you consider important, will not be important anymore. See, it's outward appearance. It's what we can see. James says this, listen, don't show favoritism. He says, love everybody unconditionally and show them the love of Christ. You know, there's a lot of times we can become insensitive, angry, because people aren't the way we are. But the fact of the matter is, regardless of who they are, God loves them and God cares. I've often thought, and I've told my church this, my son is going through a class. In the class, they're having to study about homosexuality and hatred toward the homosexuals. And they're trying to teach him to be accepting. We had several parents that came to us and they said, Pastor, you need to come and you need to stand with us. Tell them that you do not want this book in the school. And as I looked at the book and as I read the book, I thought, you know, my son is going to encounter this in the world at some point. And he can either do it with my oversight and me teaching him what's right and wrong, or I can try to shield him from the world completely. And there's going to come a day where he's going to be put face to face with this. He's going to have to deal with it without me. And so me and my wife, we began to read the book and began to do some research on the book. And one of the things that it was basically that I took from the book was this, that you're not to hate the homosexual. I want to say something. I don't mean to offend anybody here. But I want to tell you that today there is a God that died
for every homosexual in the world. And that God loves them. He does not condone the sin. He does not approve of it. And it is still a sin that can send people to hell. That will send people to hell. But I want to tell you that in this world, the Christian needs to love and at least extend the love of Christ to each person and try to help them come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. I can tell you that at this church, no, I would never put a person who was dealing with homosexuality in their life in the leadership. I would never try to put a person in a place where they would be leading other people, but neither would I look at somebody that came into the church and they were sincerely trying to find answers for their life and was dealing with homosexuality. Neither would I tell them, you cannot come back into this place. Because that's not a sin that is beyond forgiveness. But it is a sin that needs to be dealt with and needs to come underneath the blood of Jesus Christ and forsake it. You see, in our world, we can become kinds that we judge things based on outward appearance. But the fact of the matter is, God loves people. He will always love people. He will always care for people. And if He died for them, my job is to tell them Jesus loves you. And He wants to change your life. You know, we can take and judge it however you want to judge it. We have seen in the news this week of Ferguson. We have heard of people that have been shouting that it's prejudice, that there was people that was done wrong, there was injustice. Regardless, I was not in the room to hear what the grand jury said, but you want to know something, or hear the evidence that was given that the grand jury said. What I can tell you is this, that there was people that was his peers that made a decision, both white and black. And today, I am sorry that there is a man that went into eternity. But I can tell you this too. That God wanted justice to be done in that situation. One thing that I questioned, and as we hear all the news, the thought that went through my mind was, we would not even be having this argument today about whether it was just or unjust if a young man was simply got out of the middle of the road and walked on the sidewalk. And today there's people in St. Louis that march and they are judging things based on things that they may not even know. It's just based on outward appearance. But we must be the kind of people as Christians that we don't just judge people and give up on them because of what we see on the outside. Because it's the inside that God's concerned about. And He says, I love you. And I care for you. As Brother Troy comes back to the piano today, I hope you wouldn't think any less of me as I have been thinking about this scripture. And I were to tell you that I have to guard against favoritism and prejudice. Because there's a world out there that's filled with it. It's in the news. And we hear things on the news and it angers us one way or the other, however you want to feel about it. And they make us take sides. And we have favoritism that begins in our life. We start becoming prejudiced. But I've got some news for you today. That's not the way God wants us to be. God wants us to love people. God wants us to care for one another the same way regardless. Doesn't mean we have to condone what they do. It doesn't mean that we approve of what they do. But He says love them. It's God's job to change people. I like the song that the Gaither Trio sings. It says, I catch them, God cleans them. I can't change one heart. I can't change one life. I can't guilt people into doing things differently. God has to change lives. With heads bowed and eyes closed today, I'm raising my hand to tell you, listen, as pastors, you can deal with this. Not only from the money perspective, but just things that go on around the world, you can become prejudiced and have favorites. That's not what God wants. But this is something that James says is important in your life, that you be just toward all people. I'm going to leave it with God. I've delivered the message today. I'm going to leave it with God to speak to your heart. But how many of you would raise your hand with me and would say, Pastor, I have some prejudice in my heart about certain issues, maybe about the way people live, certain actions they do. And you would raise your hand, yes, I see this hand. I see hands going up all over the place. The world tries to make us take sides. God doesn't want us to take sides to a point that we will quit reaching out to people. But he says, see them through my eyes. I want you to just think for a moment what Jesus saw through his eyes as he hung on the cross. As he hung on that cross, he saw those who had whipped him. As he hung on that cross, he had seen people that had spat upon him. As he hung on that cross, he saw people who had driven the nails through his side, the nails through his hands and his feet. He had seen the person that had put the spear through his side and the blood and water flowed. And even in the midst of all of that, he was able to speak with his dying breath, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And I ask you today, how many of you went that far? Probably none of us. And if he can say, I love them and I reach out to them, it's our job to care and love for them too. Jesus, as I come to you today, Lord, this message spoke to my heart, went through, it pierced me. Because God, so often, I can be partial. I can show favoritism. Lord, help me to see people the way you see people. As dying and going into eternity without without a relationship with you, Jesus. And that, Lord, I have no right to hear the gospel twice when there's those that have never heard it once. That, Lord, I'll take the gospel to people regardless of what they look like, regardless of what they believe or how they act. That when people walk into this church, God, that I can drop what I'm doing to take and go back and shake their hand. I'm able to go back and talk to them. I'm able to go back and show them the love of God, even though their life may not match up with the Word, even though I may not even agree with the way they live. But God, I'm willing to go and I'm willing to show love. I'm able to show concern to the lost, knowing they need to have a relationship with you. That they're needing to forsake their sin, and that, Lord, maybe the only way they'll do that is if I show them the love of Jesus. God, help each and every one of us to recognize that one of the vital signs that we'll have in our life is that we love people. Lord, even if they don't love us, they don't even want us to love them. But God, we will be impartial, and that we will love and we'll care. Lord, as we do it, you will begin to do great things here in our church and in our community, because we love people, and it's not about the numbers, it's not about the money, it's not what they can offer, it's nothing like that. It's simply because you love them, and because you love them, we love them as well. Jesus, today, work and move in our lives and change us. Let's stand together. Let's sing this song as we close out this service. Let's make it a prayer of our heart that God, we want you to use our lives to change and do great things for you in the lives of other people.
Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts, let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts, let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation.
Keep us in your word this week as we go. Your name we ask in Jesus. Amen. Thank you for being here today. And we've been talking about showing the love of Jesus Christ. Now, before you grab the purse, if you got to go somewhere, we understand. Do that. But if you just take and shake hands with some folks around you on the way out, tell them that God loves them, that you love them, and we're happy to have them here in real life with God. Lord bless you this week. Go in the grace of the Lord.
Generation that sings, seek your face.